little mystery, coupled with a great disappointment, surrounded the early years of this century in the search for new planets in the region of the solar system known as the Kuiper Belt. This search led to the discovery of several large asteroids, or planetoids. Anyone who followed the events of those years will also recall that after a period of exciting discoveries, culminating in 2003 with the finding of Eris, even hailed at the time as the 10th planet, the flow of good news from the Kuiper Belt almost suddenly ceased. Since then, only routine discoveries and no new Eris on the horizon. This despite the discoveries expressing optimism earlier about the possibility that this remote region could host dozens of other objects the size of Eris and Pluto. Could it be that the Kuiper Belt mine had already exhausted its best pieces? Or perhaps, more simply, had people grown tired of searching? Or was there something else? The suspicion lingers. So what if we try to uncover the truth together with the help of this super interesting video? Are you up for it? Great! Let's get started then. Okay, but not so fast. First, we need to say something more about the remote region at the center of the whole story, the Kuiper Belt. When we think of the solar system, rocky planets like Earth, gas giants like Jupiter, natural satellites like the Moon, and asteroids orbiting between Mars and Jupiter come to mind. However, the solar system doesn't end there. Beyond Neptune, the farthest planet from the Sun, extends a vast region populated by millions of icy objects, which are probably remnants of the material used to build the solar system. This region is called the Kuiper Belt, named after the Dutch-American astronomer Gerard Kuiper, who hypothesized its existence in 1951, building on studies conducted a decade earlier by the Irish astronomer Kenneth Edgeworth. In fact, it would be more accurate to call it the Edgeworth-Kuiper Belt. The belt is located at a distance from the Sun ranging from 30 to 50 astronomical units, or AUs, where 1 AU is the average distance between Earth and the Sun, about 150 million kilometers. It contains at least 100,000 objects with a diameter exceeding 100 kilometers, although many more are believed to exist, too small or faint to be detected. The most famous of these objects is, of course, Pluto, the dwarf planet that was considered the 9th planet of the solar system until 2006. But Pluto is not alone. In the last 20 years, thanks to technological advancements in telescopes, many other objects of similar size to Pluto, 2,450 kilometers in diameter, have been discovered. Objects like Eris, 2,326 kilometers, Makemake, 1,430 kilometers, Haumea, 1,595, Quawar, 1,086, and others, all with a diameter exceeding 1,000 kilometers. These objects are called Kbos, an acronym for Kuiper Belt objects, and they vary greatly in shape, size, color, composition, and orbit. Some are round, others elongated, and still others irregular. Some are red, others gray, and some are white. Some are made of water ice, others of methane ice, and still others of nitrogen ice. Some orbit near the plane of the ecliptic, while others have highly inclined or eccentric orbits. Some have one or more satellites, while others are solitary. In essence, Kbos are genuine worlds that tell us the story of the solar system and challenge us to explore and understand them better. The Kuiper Belt is the true frontier of the solar system and represents a significant opportunity for science and adventure. However, this frontier bears little resemblance to the solar system as we know it. The American astronomer Fred Whipple once said that if we want to continue considering the solar system according to the familiar representation still used in many educational materials, with the Sun at the center of a system of ordered ellipses, it becomes really challenging to include the remote, chaotic, and mysterious regions beyond Neptune. If instead we strive to see it as a complex and continuously interacting physical system, with the Sun at the center of a vast sphere of influence extending tens of thousands of astronomical units away, populated by a myriad of exotic objects and only a small minority of familiar objects located in its immediate vicinity, the known planets and satellites, then our vision of the system changes profoundly. Until 30 years ago, the existence of the Oort cloud, as well as that of the closer Kuiper Belt, were only working hypotheses. Until the early years of this century, the region beyond Neptune and Pluto seemed inhabited only by a sparse representation of normal asteroids. Credit for the past hypotheses of the something that wasn't there yet goes to visionaries like Kenneth Edgeworth and Gerard Kuiper. However, it's the astronomer Michael Brown, a professor of planetary astronomy at the California Institute of Technology, who deserves credit for contributing in recent years to filling those distant regions with real objects. However, and here is where we get into the topic, it was only from 2002 to 2007 that things truly started to get serious. Almost always in collaboration with Chad Trujillo, the discoverer in 1992 of the first object found in the Kuiper Belt, Brown, during those years, unleashed the imagination of astronomers and enthusiasts alike by populating those regions with objects of almost planetary dimensions, including the largest of them all, Eris, much more massive than Pluto itself. Those were formidable years, one might say. But from 2007 onwards, it seemed that the exciting series of discoveries had suddenly come to a halt, just when there was hope for the discovery of something even more sensational. To some, it almost seemed like the Prague conference in 2006, which had decreed Pluto's demotion from the rank of the planet, put an end to the discoveries, demotivating researchers and effectively transforming the search for new planets into the less fascinating and lucrative search for dwarf planets. The last major KBO, GongGong, 1,230 kilometers in diameter, was discovered in 2007. Since then, only routine discoveries and no new Eris on the horizon. The question at this point is, did things really go as rumored? Was there a slowdown on the researchers' part? Before moving on, don't forget to subscribe to our channel if you haven't already. Make sure to hit the notification bell so you don't miss out on our daily videos. Well, not exactly, and Brown himself explains it. In practice, Brown states that the ability to find all those objects in such a short time was certainly not the result of chance, but of observational survey methods that had covered both the northern and the southern celestial hemispheres, leaving only the region of the galactic plane and the ecliptic poles unexplored. It was certainly possible, as Brown reports, that some particularly bright KBOs might have escaped detection. But numerous statistical studies indicated that observational campaigns had an efficiency rate between 70% and 90%. This led to the belief that the large KBOs yet to be found must be very few. At that point, it was decided that organizing a survey to cover the missing areas would be too costly for the expected results, and it was only for this reason that the discovery seemed to abruptly cease. In other words, it was not deemed useful to initiate new research programs. Furthermore, the fact that all the major KBOs identified up to that point could be traced back even in old archival images led researchers and Michael Brown to believe that, instead of starting new observational programs, they could systematically exploit the existence of already established archives. An ideal dataset was immediately identified in the one created by the Catalina Sky Survey, an American project that used three telescopes to discover and monitor the so-called near-Earth objects, NEOs. Two of these instruments, 1.5 and 0.7 meters in diameter, are located in Arizona, while the third, 0.5 meters, is in Australia at the Siding Spring Observatory, where it contributed to the Siding Spring Survey in the Southern Celestial Hemisphere. As we know, NEOs are asteroids, comets, and meteoroids that can pose an impact risk to our planet, and that's the reason justifying a dedicated project to scour the sky inch by inch to discover them. Brown and company were not interested in NEOs at all, but only in the images produced by the Catalina Sky Survey over the years of continuous research. Those images were perfect for their purposes. The survey had covered a whopping 19,700 square degrees of the sky. Remember that the entire celestial sphere is formed by 41,253 square degrees, between a declination of minus 25 degrees to plus 70 degrees. Meanwhile, the Siding Spring Survey had archived 14,100 square degrees from minus 80 degrees to 0 degrees. Taking into account the overlapping areas, the overall useful coverage was about 30,000 square degrees, three-quarters of the entire sky. The limiting magnitude for the two surveys was plus 19.4 and plus 18.9 respectively, sufficient to allow the detection of large objects in the Kuiper Belt. Each observation area had been captured several times over 7 years, from 2005 to 2012. At that point, they had to figure out how to proceed. It had been calculated that in those 30,000 square degrees of the sky, approximately 3.9 billion transient events could have been photographed, about 130,000 per square degree. For transient event, we mean a dot of light on the plate that does not correspond to any known object, but can be anything: a supernova, a flare, an artifact, a main belt asteroid, a small NEO, a cosmic ray. How to distinguish a real KBO then from everything else? As one can imagine, this was neither easy nor immediate. But to begin with, using a digital blink comparator, all those dots that persist without showing the slightest movement over time can be eliminated. Moreover, we know that a KBO, on average, more than 25 AU away, cannot exhibit proper motion higher than 4.9 arc seconds per hour under any conditions. Anything moving faster, NEOs, main belt asteroids, pairs of artifacts, etc., is therefore discarded. Well, even after this double selection, there were still a lot of dots left, 3.5 million. At this point, the so-called keplerian filter comes to the rescue. All the dots that night after night seem to indicate the movement of an object are examined by software that each time asks the question, does this sequence of dots meet the criteria of an object moving in a keplerian orbit? If the answer is reasonably positive within preset limits, and if the magnitude does not show suspicious jumps, then the case is classified as a probable KBO. At the end of the entire process, complicated also by the application of more complex identification or removal algorithms, Brown and his team found themselves dealing with 1,192 probable KBOs in the Northern Hemisphere and 5,515 in the Southern Hemisphere. A sufficiently small number, obviously many of these cases were the result of multiple observations related to the same object, to allow the evaluation of each individual entry. And that's how the initial dense daisy remained with only 8 petals. This, metaphorically speaking, meant that thanks to the Catalina survey, Brown and colleagues had successfully identified the existence of 8 large planetary objects belonging to the Kuiper Belt. Experiment successful then? Well, not exactly. It's almost funny to say, but the 8 KBOs that survived the screening were objects discovered and cataloged many years ago, and almost all found by Brown himself. Read their names and you'll understand right away. Makemake, Eris, Orcus, Haumea, and even Nereid, yes, Neptune's small moon. In practice, neglecting the almost humorous side of things, we can summarize the whole story like this. The analysis of the Catalina survey had widely achieved its goal and had proven so valid that it had detected within 100% efficiency the presence of all those KBOs that, during the years when the archive was being formed, were below the instrumental limiting magnitude, except Pluto, which during that period was immersed in the Milky Way, and Quarwar, located at the limit of an uncovered region. And the fact that the survey did not highlight the existence of even one entirely new KBO can mean only one thing. Below that magnitude, there's nothing left to discover. Or at least, very little. In reality, in the article, Brown leaves some hope, in the sense that, as we mentioned earlier, the Catalina survey left regions around the ecliptic pole uncovered, corresponding to about 20% of the total sky. This added to the faint possibility that something might prove in the unexplored and unexploitable areas occupied by the galactic plane leads the American astronomer to calculate a 32% probability that there is still a large KBO to be discovered and a 10% probability that there are 2. Can we be at peace then? Have we already found all the dwarf planets in the solar system? The answer is no, for at least 2 good reasons. The first is in the small door left open by the incomplete coverage of the survey. Remember that even Eris has an orbit strongly inclined to the ecliptic, which allows us to hope that regions north of the ecliptic might still hold surprises. Well, the second reason is that we have not searched everywhere. The so-called oort cloud remains to be explored, or at least its inner part, where numerous simulations suggest the existence of planets the size of Mars or Earth. Due to their distance from the Sun, however, these still hypothetical objects are too faint to be discovered with current technologies. We'll have to be patient, or hope for that 32% calculated by Brown. Nevertheless, it is quite a challenging task that will require all the observational power of next-generation telescopes, from both ground and space, such as the James Webb or the Extremely Large Telescope, a 39-meter telescope from the ESO under construction in the Atacama Desert in Chile. In fact, it is precisely from the latter, which will be ready in 2026, and will photograph the sky reaching magnitude plus 29, that we expect the biggest news. So let's be patient. A few more years, and no planet or planetoid will be able to escape us, no matter where it hides.